hear me, right?
Yes.
Well, I am so grateful to be here this morning. I told this small group this morning that I am no stranger to Burlington. I grew up in Levittown, which is, I think that Kim said maybe one or two of you might be even from Levittown. Yeah. What section?
I lived in Apple Tree.
Oh, Apple Tree. Okay, Cobalt Ridge.
Okay.
All right, so if you come from Levittown, you always come from a section. That's the whole thing. And when I first learned how to drive, I have a tremendously terrible sense of direction. And so for me, because we didn't have GPS back there and I couldn't read the map for a lick, the way that I found myself around was looking for Burlington-Bristol Bridge signs. If I could find a Burlington-Bristol Bridge sign, I felt that I was on my way home. And so, and then my dad for about 5 years worked at the butcher shop on High Street. So I am grateful to be in Burlington this morning with you. Last Sunday, I was in East Orange, New Jersey. And I took a gamble, which I know is a bad thing for a Methodist, but I still did. I couldn't help myself because, well, if I'm looking back at it, I would take this chance again. Because despite the fact that I was solidly in Giants territory, I took a chance and talked about my Philadelphia Eagles.
Amen.
You see, for my husband and my son and my son-in-law, last Sunday night was like Christmas and their birthdays wrapped up together. And so we sat down at 6:40 and we didn't know how the night would play out. But I thought, you know what, I'm gonna make sure that I don't miss this moment of excitement. Now, I think probably being solidly in Philadelphia Eagles story, I don't need to tell you about their season. You know, well, on December 11th, I was sitting there when Carson Wentz, that young, bright, promising quarterback, got his season-ending injury. My husband, at the end of the game, he said, you know, I've never felt so sad at the end of a win. I don't even know what to do with this. Because knowing that being Philadelphia fans for a long, long time, we know that these are the things that often happen and lead to disappointing ends of season. But you know, something different happened this time. Something that maybe Carson's pure talent might have kind of overshadowed. And that was that, interestingly enough, they were a team. They had developed an ability to work together in an amazing way with teamwork. And possibly this happened because all eyes were on Carson Wentz and not on the rest of the players. If you're an athlete, even if you're in a solo sport, you need the support of a team to be successful. In the same way, we as Christians can't go it alone. We need each other for help and for support. One of the things that I am blessed with working in the conference office is that we work together as an amazing team of people. And I've recognized that this is not just a resource for us together, but it is something that we need because it is biblical. And so today I want to talk to you a little bit about being God's team. Will you pray with me, please? Amazing God, I thank you for this church. I thank you for the many years in which the people of this church have served you faithfully. Thank you for their participation in Team Vital and their willingness to step up and step out in faith to be your team. Amen. So Moses and Nehemiah and Solomon all worked as part of a team to accomplish the will of God. Jesus himself could have done everything. He was God, and yet he chose a team of people. And it was because of that team of people that we are sitting here today. It was a group of people with diverse gifts that came together and birthed the church. And the scriptures describe the church as a body. And as a human body, it is not a single organ that is the most important, but it is all the pieces working together that helps the body be healthy. No single person, including your pastor, has enough time or energy to grow a church all by themselves. I know often as a local pastor, I just came out of the local church, having served there for 16 years, and often people look to me for everything. And instead, I needed to look back and ask for the help of the people that were sitting before me. Because together, just like the eye can't do it alone or the kidney can't do it alone, but together, as a full body, we could be kingdom of God on earth as it is in heaven. You know, we have a tendency in the church to look to certain people to take up most of the burden. And it isn't always the pastor. Sometimes it's the children's leaders, or the musicians, or the treasurer that often feel very alone in ministry. Sometimes being a leader can be very overwhelming. The expectations that we put on ourselves to try to figure out everything is too much. Has anybody ever been there? I've been there. Instead, what we need to do is break it down, divide it up, and delegate it out. And sometimes, as leaders, we need to let go a little bit too. But that is how we become the church that God has called us to be. As I look over your website, your Facebook page, and read over your newsletter, I was able to see that you at Broad Street United Methodist Church are truly blessed to have a team of very talented and gifted people who come together faithfully to work together as a church in mission and in ministry. I could see that in a typical week, there were people who were in prayer for the pastor and the congregation, your neighborhood, and the world. There were Bible studies and small groups in which I was excited that you wrote those all down there. Children's activities, people visiting the sick and the shut-ins, people who were involved in missions. There were trustees to oversee the care of the church, cleaners and property maintenance, people who cook and bake for events, those who are in need are cared for by members of this community, those who run retreats and do children's ministry and gather people together. There are people who make coffee and buy treats and greet you on Sunday morning. And every week there are a team of people who take care of the finances. There's musicians who practice regularly and perform. The list goes on and on and on. The dictionary describes a team as a group of organized together for the purpose of working together toward a common goal or project. It says that the team has a unified goal. For the Philadelphia Eagles, it's to win the Super Bowl. But what does it look like for Broad Street United Methodist Church to have a win? Part of the process of moving toward that goal is getting organized, and that's exactly what your church did when it joined Team Vital. It began to look at ways to be a more vital church that is transforming lives for the building up of God's kingdom. When I looked at your mission statement, I saw that your mission was us to proclaim, care, praise, serve, and grow. And so for you, a win is when you work together to proclaim God's love, to care for one another, to serve your community and the world, so that you will grow in faith. Praise God, you have a win. Because a team is much more than a group that just works together, that's why you need small groups. Because it isn't just about doing the work. It's about building relationships and building trust with one another, getting to respect and care for each other, being connected beyond whatever task you have in the ministry that you do. That means a team begins with relationships. We need to see that everyone has a part in the process, and they know that their piece is connected to a bigger picture. That's why I love the puzzle pieces. They're perfect because a puzzle is not complete when you just have one piece. Actually, it isn't complete when one piece is missing. And it takes all the pieces being connected together that makes a success possible. We're not meant to live in silos, but instead we need one another. You know, I have watched the Philadelphia Eagles for a lot of years, and I know that some years we have had some amazingly talented players, but they failed to bring a win for the team because they were more interested in building up themselves than building relationships with their teammates. So I ask you, how are you putting yourself out there to be in relationship with the people in your church and in your community? In doing the work of the kingdom of God, it is always important that we encourage and we motivate one another. And one of the proven ways to do that is through small group ministry. You know, what do you do? This is a time you're going to talk back to me. What do you do to engage in relationships with one another? What do you do to encourage one another? Just shout something out.
Shoot a text in the middle of the week.
Shoot a text in the middle. So be in connection beyond the church. There are other ways you stay connected. Honestly.
Yes, go out to lunch.
Go out to lunch. I want to go to that Shrove Tuesday pancake breakfast. That sounds pretty yummy to me.
Dinner.
Just food in general.
Yeah, food in general. Come together through meals. What other ways do you connect as a church together with one another?
Coffee hour.
Email thank yous to jobs well done.
Okay, how super. Often people do things and, you know, it's done today and gone tomorrow, and it seems like it's out of everyone's mind. Called by phone, okay? Yeah.
Marsha always writes great notes.
Good notes, yes. We rarely get mail anymore, so a nice note is always nice.
Christmas cards.
All of these ways help us to remain connected with one another. You know, small groups are much like a sports team. One player or one leader does not make a winning team. Although the one person might lead the group as a shepherd, that person needs all the people in the rest of the group to contribute, all the gifts that are available there. Now, for some of you, you may lead, be a part of a small group, and your thing is hospitality. So you're the one who always makes sure that things look a little special. You know, the coffee is extra good. You lay out the table well. Others, you lead in administration so that you make sure that our Methodist and background, and you lead in that. Others, you are servers and you serve one another. Then there are those who are encouragers, those who contribute to others' needs and show mercy. And what happens is when you put it all together, what do you have? A team. You know, a team is not a whole bunch of quarterbacks, no matter how talented they are, coming together. You need the offense and the defense and all the different, the special teams. Everything that comes together makes a winning team. You are all. So I want you to say that word, all.
All.
You are all called to be a part of this team. You know, I think we get wired in our head that church or service in church is like the playground when you were in fifth grade. When you were in fifth grade and you wanted to be a part of the team, you needed to wait for someone to ask you to join their team. But that isn't the way it is in church life. God has already invited you to be a part of the team. So if you are not working in a part of an area of the church right now, if you're not a part of a small group, if you're not on mission together with the people who are sitting here, well, if people aren't reaching out to you, I want you to start reaching out to them. It is your time now to step up, because your team here at Broad Street United Methodist Church needs you. You know, I think to be Nick Foles on that December day must have been pretty darn scary. And it probably has been scary every Sunday since then. You know, how do you compare yourself to someone who was such a natural and amazing athlete, and you're not as young as he was? But you know what? He was who he was. He was Nick. And that's why they're there now. And it was because of the team that rallied behind his gifts, uniquely his gifts, and didn't keep playing as well as like it was Carson Wentz, that they are where they are now. I invite you to step up and be uniquely who God has called you to be, and for this team of people to rally around each of their players so that this team can win at proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ. God has a place for each and every one of you. But that's only part of the process. You have to be the one to step up and take the risk. You need to take your position as part of the team. In this very divided world that we have, the ability to come together as a team is priceless. And I believe if the church does not model that for the world, I don't know how people will ever see unity. How they will see that it is important not just to tolerate one another, but instead to encourage and love one another when no one else will. So a few months ago, my husband and I went and we toured the Eagles' home field. Now, honestly, I did it because I really just wanted to make my husband happy. Well, we had a couple days off, and I was like, oh, this makes him happy, let's do it. But as we got through the tour, I thought, well, this isn't half bad. So we got to this one place, and I thought it was pretty cool. We got to the tunnel, and it was just us on the tour, and the guy there, he flicks on the lights and he flicks on the music, and he goes, yeah, you could just run down this tunnel just like the players do. And you could run down the tunnel and or walk like I did. And you could go out on the field. And you know, funny thing was, it was a rainy day in the spring. There was really very few people in the entire stadium except for us. But in that moment, it was pretty exciting. You see, I knew that that was the place where all the excitement began. That was the place, as my old disciple Bible school teacher would say, rubber meets the road. That was the place when things get real. You at Broad Street United Methodist Church, you have a choice to not just get by, or survive, but instead to thrive. And you are called to bring together people of all different walks of life to love Jesus, to love their neighbor, and to come together as part of this team to serve your community. This is your moment. This is the moment that you are standing in the tunnel, and the music is playing, and the lights are on. Can you feel the excitement? Are you ready to enter the playing field? Go team.
Amen.